Will right, North Carolina then consider it changed once it is changed?
Yes, so they, if you, as long as you have a letter and have done the surgery, for sure, there's not.
First of all, thank you all for coming. This is LGBT Law 101, otherwise known as Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, and Transgender Law 101. We have a number of great speakers today, and I wanted to introduce them quickly and then turn it over to them. First, we have Erwin Chemerinsky, the Alston Bird Professor of Law and Political Science, whose focus, as many of you know, has included constitutional law and policy. Professor Chemerinsky will be talking about constitutional issues as they relate to sexual orientation and the Lawrence v. Texas decision. Next, we have Kathy Bradley, is a senior lecturing fellow at Duke Law School. Professor Bradley teaches family law and legal ethics. She's also the legal director, of legal ethics and the administrator of the Capstone Project and domestic externships. Professor Bradley will be discussing family law generally as it relates to same-sex couples, domestic partnerships, custody disputes, and parenting agreements, and how full faith and credit, how the full faith and credit doctrine ties into all that. Next, we have Sharon Thompson. And she actually, just so you know, may have to leave just a tad early to make it to court. So she's not leaving us because she doesn't like us. She's the founder of the Sharon Thompson Law Group here in Durham, North Carolina, and a former legislator of the North Carolina House of Representatives. The Sharon Thompson Law Group specializes in family law, and Sharon will be discussing in more detail the state of North Carolina family law as it relates to LGBT families, particularly second parent adoption, and perhaps some highlights of what's been going through the courts on the appellate level. And Janie Long, on the end, is the director of the Center for Gay, Lesbian, and Bisexual and Transgender Life here at Duke. Her focus has, throughout her career, been on social justice issues. She has a PhD in family therapy, and for over the last 15 years has focused on LGBT issues, both as a scholar and an educator. And Janie will be speaking about transgender issues, Duke University's current policies, and around gender identity and expression, and some of the recent challenges they've faced here at Duke. And finally, before I hand over the mic to our panelists, I wanted to share one quick narrative that for me kind of really highlights some of the inequalities present in the law today for LGBT families. And this is about a woman named Monica Hill. She served in the military for over 8 years. She got a scholarship in 1994 to go through medical school with the Air Force and finished that, went to her residency. And in the summer of June 2001, her partner of 14 years became very ill, and it ended up that she had lung cancer and it was terminal. Monica was about to be transferred to a permanent active duty station in Virginia, and that's not where they were living at the time. And she requested, her partner got so sick that she couldn't really even move around the house. And so she requested, the only option she thought she had was a deferment. So she could take 2 years off and take care of her partner. They gave her partner between 2 months and 2 years to live. In the coming months, the Air Force initiated dischargement. They just discharged her under Don't Ask, Don't Tell, based on her testimony of filling out those forms for the family crisis she was going through. And they kicked her out. Her partner, Terry, died September 11th of 2001, just 2 months after she requested the leave. And in the coming months, they also initiated recoupment proceedings against her to recoup the money they spent for her medical degree. She's now practicing medicine privately, but not with the military anymore. So that's just one narrative, I think, that highlights how some of the laws currently can really be a double bind for a lot of LGBT families in a variety of situations. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Erwin Chemerinsky. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. I was asked to talk about the Constitution as it relates to sexual orientation. I think what I would say is at this point, two cheers, or maybe just a cheer and a half for the Supreme Court. In order to understand what I'm going to say, for those of you who are first-year law students, I need to preview something you'll be coming to soon in constitutional law. And for those of you who are second and third-year students, review something for you that's very familiar from constitutional law. And that's whenever the Supreme Court deals with discrimination under equal protection, with claims of rights under the Constitution, everything depends on what's called the level of scrutiny. The degree to which the court defers to the legislature or carefully scrutinizes what the legislature says. Generally, the court follows what's called rational basis review. Under rational basis review, a law is upheld so long as the government action is rationally related to a legitimate government purpose. The government's purpose just to be something that's permissible for the government to do. In fact, it doesn't even have to be the government's actual purpose. Any conceivable legitimate purpose is enough. And the means chosen just has to be reasonable, a rational way to achieve the end. The reality is that the government almost always wins under rational basis review. I can count on less than the fingers of one hand the number of Supreme Court cases where the government has lost under rational basis review since 1937. Then there's what's called intermediate scrutiny. Under intermediate scrutiny, a law is upheld if the government action is substantially related to an important government purpose. The government's goal has to be more than just something that's legitimate for the government to do. The court has to believe the government's objective is important. And the means have to be substantially related, a very good way to achieve the end. Here, the government has the burden of proof. Gender discrimination, for example, in our society, according to the Supreme Court, has to meet intermediate scrutiny. And then there's strict scrutiny. Under strict scrutiny, the law has to be necessary to achieve a compelling government purpose. The government is going to have to show that it has a vital, a crucial, a compelling interest. The court's going to look only at the government's actual purpose. A conceivable, compelling purpose isn't good enough. And the means have to be necessary. The least restrictive alternative. The government usually loses under strict scrutiny. The reason I begin with this is that the Supreme Court and its protection so far, based on sexual orientation, has used only rational basis review. And so I would cheer the court for finding some protection, but the problem is by using only rational basis review, it hasn't provided very much protection. And lower courts have read its decisions as providing very little protection. There have been two Supreme Court cases dealing with sexual orientation discrimination, or the rights that go along with sexual orientation. The first was a case in 1996, Romer versus Evans. Romer versus Evans involved a Colorado law, an initiative passed by the voters, Amendment 2, that repealed all laws in the state protecting gays and lesbians from discrimination, and prohibiting the enactment of any new laws protecting gays and lesbians from discrimination. The Supreme Court declared the law unconstitutional. Justice Kennedy wrote the opinion for the court. He expressly used only rational basis review. He said, this law keeps gays and lesbians from using the political process in a way that every other group can use the political process. Any other group, law professors, journalists, welfare recipients, can go to the legislature and get statutes protecting themselves. But gays and lesbians can't. They can only get protection by going through the constitutional amendment process, which is much more difficult. So the only reason for singling out a group and keeping them from using the political process is animus against the group. He said, animus is never a legitimate government purpose. Now, it's not that the court rejected intermediate or strict scrutiny for sexual orientation discrimination. It's just that the court here said, since this law failed rational basis review, there was no need to go any further. One can't read in this case any authority for lower courts using intermediate or strict scrutiny. The other Supreme Court case was Lawrence versus Texas in June of 2003. Now, in order to understand Lawrence, you need to go back to a Supreme Court case from 1986, Bowers versus Hardwick. Bowers involved a Georgia statute prohibiting all oral genital or anal genital contacts. Police officer came to deliver a bench warrant, asked if a man was present. The guy who answered the door apparently said, I don't know if he's here or not. Go check in his room. The officer said the door to the room was open a crack. He peered in and saw two men on the bed engaged in sexual activity in violation of the Georgia statute. The men were arrested. The state decided not to prosecute them, but they brought their own civil action for declaratory judgment to have the law declared unconstitutional. The Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, upheld the statute as constitutional. Justice Byron White wrote the opinion for the court, said the court should only protect rights if they're in the text, or if the framers intended them, with a long tradition of protecting rights. So there's no textual right to engage in private, consensual, same-sex sexual activity. The framers obviously didn't discuss it. And he said, as recently as 1961, all 50 states had laws prohibiting this. And he said, therefore, there's no constitutional protection. Chief Justice Warren Burger wrote a concurring opinion that was incredibly offensive, saying that it's often been thought that homosexual activity is just as objectionable as murder, and that, of course, states can prohibit private, consensual, same-sex sexual behavior. An interesting aspect of this case is a fifth justice in the majority was Justice Lewis Powell, and soon after going off the Supreme Court, Justice Powell, in a speech at New York University Law School, said he made a mistake in Bowers versus Hardwick. He regretted his vote and wished he had voted with the four dissenting justices to make a majority. In 2003, in Lawrence versus Texas, the Supreme Court expressly overruled Bowers versus Hardwick. Lawrence involved a Texas law prohibiting so-called deviant sexual activity. It applied only to same-sex sexual activity, whereas the Georgia law prohibited heterosexual oral sex or anal sex. The Texas law just applied to same-sex couples. Police got a report of disturbing peace. They went to investigate. They entered an apartment, clearly violating the Fourth Amendment, and they said they discovered two men engaged in sexual activity. In this instance, the men were criminally prosecuted. They were convicted. They were fined, and they took their case up through the Texas system, including losing in the Texas Court of Criminal Appeals. The Supreme Court, in a 6-3 decision, overturned the Texas law. Justice Kennedy wrote for the majority, joined by Justice Stevens, Souter, Ginsburg, and Breyer. Justice O'Connor concurred in the judgment. Justice Kennedy, in eloquent language, said, if the right to privacy means anything, it's what consenting adults do in their own bedroom. He said, Bowers versus Hardwick had phrased the issue as to whether there's a fundamental right to engage in homosexual sodomy. He said, that's not the issue at all. He says, it's about whether or not privacy in the bedroom protects consenting adults. He talked about the very existence of laws like Texas having a stigmatizing effect, harmful effect. He said there's a tremendous trend, both nationally and internationally, to the rejection of such laws. Justice O'Connor, concurring in the judgment, said she wouldn't overrule Bowers. She'd been the majority in Bowers. She said she would just find the Texas law unconstitutional because it prohibits same-sex sexual activity that it allows between opposite-sex couples. The problem with Justice Kennedy's opinion, despite its eloquence, is it never says what the level of scrutiny is that it's using. Never does Justice Kennedy say there's a fundamental right, strict scrutiny. He certainly cites to some cases that deal with privacy as a fundamental right that use strict scrutiny. Nor does he say he's using rational basis review. But at one point he says the Texas law serves no legitimate interest. And the key issue in litigation after Lawrence in the lower courts has been, what's the level of scrutiny in Lawrence? And the lower courts have consistently interpreted as providing only rational basis review. And now you go back to where I started. If it's only rational basis review, it and Romer provide relatively little protection. Example, there was an 11th Circuit case that involved a Florida law that prohibited gays and lesbians from adopting children. Now, frankly, I think this law fails even though it was minimal rational basis review. But the 11th Circuit said Romer and Lawrence are only rational basis cases and upheld the Florida law. Another 11th Circuit case involved an Alabama law that prohibited sex toys, prohibited the sale or distribution of items intended primarily for stimulation of the genitals. Again, I think this fails even the most deferential rational basis review. What's the legitimate state interest in prohibiting sex toys? But the 11th Circuit, in a 2-1 decision, upholds the law saying Lawrence versus Texas is only rational basis review. Another example, there was a decision of the Ohio Supreme Court that involved applying Ohio's incest law to two adults who were not related by blood. It was a stepfather and his stepdaughter who were adults at the time they engaged in sex and nonetheless violated what the Ohio law deemed to be incest. And they raised Lawrence versus Texas to defense. The Ohio Supreme Court explicitly said Lawrence versus Texas is only rational basis review, upheld the statute and the convictions. I could go on and on with examples, but now you see why I begin as I did. Romer and Lawrence are terrific decisions. The rhetoric of Lawrence is wonderful, but in terms of constitutional doctrine, they're of limited value because the reality is, so long as it's just rational basis review, laws that discriminate based on sexual orientation, laws that limit private sexual activity are going to be upheld. What's key in the future is for the court to move from rational basis review to heightened scrutiny, because it's only heightened scrutiny that really will provide protection.
I have, I think, 5 or 10 minutes to tell you everything there is to know about family law as it relates to same-sex couples. And the bottom line, the takeaway message I'd want you to have is that there is so much variation in the law right now that it is imperative that same-sex couples know what their state's law is and that they do whatever that state's law allows them to do. And that if they relocate, they be very attentive to the fact that where they're moving may not offer the same protections and may not honor what they did in state one, which also means that there needs to be redundancy. So you need to have a backup system. So you can't assume that just because you're in a domestic partnership or a civil union in one state, which would confer on you spouse-like benefits, that if you move to another state, that's going to be recognized. So you need to make sure you've done things like have a will, have guardianship papers, have healthcare decision-making papers, all of those kinds of things in place that you could take for granted if you were able to have the rights of legal marriage. According to Wikipedia, which as we all know is an authoritative legal research tool, under federal law, a married couple has 1,138 rights under various federal laws based on the status of spouse, essentially. And so if you're talking about a same-sex couple where you do not get that status anywhere except the state of Massachusetts, then there's a lot of rights that do not follow. One of the things that's true about family law is that it's traditionally been the domain of the states. It's one of those areas that's so local that family law is generally governed by state law. Now, there's increasing federal intervention. There are certainly things like constitutional principles that Professor Chemerinsky's talked about that cross state lines. There are also an increasing number of federal statutes that help family law by making sure that what one state does will be honored in another state in terms of things like child support, custody arrangements, and things like that. But it also means the states are still little laboratories, which is a term you may be learning or have learned in constitutional law, in terms of being able to experiment. And what that means is there's tremendous variation right now state to state. So, for example, if you're dealing with same-sex couples, in one state, Massachusetts, same-sex marriage is legal. But it's only legal for residents of Massachusetts. They won't allow out-of-state people to come in and marry there under Massachusetts law. And if you enter into a Massachusetts same-sex marriage, then you may have to go there to dissolve it. I think Rhode Island has just held that it wasn't going to deal with an out-of-state relationship. Some states have said, well, we're not going to go as far as marriage, because marriage is special. for whatever reasons, and that gets back to the rational basis question. There are a handful of states that have civil unions that confer all of the rights of marriage but don't call it marriage, and they usually do so through a ceremony that looks kind of like a wedding. Okay, but to dissolve that, you have to go through what's basically a divorce, a dissolution proceeding, which may require you to go back to the state where the civil union was entered into in order to get the union dissolved. Since some states, like Vermont, allow non-residents to enter into civil unions, you might be in the situation where you go to Vermont, you enter into a civil union, and then what happens when you want to split up? Even though neither one of you is a resident of Vermont, you have to go back there in order to dissolve the civil union, okay? Some states have domestic partnerships, which confer a range of benefits ranging from everything that marriage confers, but we don't call it marriage, to some lesser set of health care benefits or decision-making authority and so forth. How you enter into those and how you get out of them varies state to state. Now, it'd be really nice if all states honored what every other state had done in this regard, but that's where you get back to the Constitution and the Full Faith and Credit Clause, which says that, generally speaking, one state does have to honor what another state does in terms of a judgment of one state's court being honored in another state's court. But there is, at least for, not for judgments necessarily, but for public policies and laws for statutes, there's a public policy exception. So if Massachusetts, its public policy is to allow same-sex marriage, and that's contrary to the policy of Virginia, and it is, then Virginia doesn't have to recognize what Massachusetts has done. The feds have made that a statute under the Defense of Marriage Act, which is a federal statute, and most states have something in place that's referred to as a mini-DOMA that says they will not honor same-sex marriage that's undertaken in another state, that it doesn't count as marriage in their state. And so what that means is that, unlike marriage, where everybody knows what marriage is, and if you move across state lines, generally speaking, the rights are going to move with you, that doesn't happen for same-sex couples. And to the extent that there is some, you know, there's some ability to move, it matters if the state that you're moving to has rights similar to the state that you moved from. So if you move from a state that has a domestic partnership scheme to a state that has a domestic partnership scheme or a civil union, you're likely to have a lot more protection than if you move from a state that has such a scheme to a state that has nothing. And that means you just have to be very, very careful, much more tuned in on what the law is where you live, much more thoughtful about where you're going to move. I had a student who graduated last year, and he and his partner were deciding where to move, and they were going to be working in D.C. so they could live in Virginia, D.C., or Maryland. What they encounter in each of those jurisdictions is dramatically different. And, you know, what I said is, under no circumstances would I move into the state of Virginia, okay? Because the rights that are going to come are so limited at this point, and it's so much easier to just move across the jurisdiction's lines into D.C. and have some protections you wouldn't have elsewhere. So you have to be much more attuned to that. So what happens if you're in a same-sex relationship and you've got some sort of a formal mechanism in place, and then you split up? Well, it depends, again, on where you were when you entered into the relationship, what kind of formal relationship you have. You may have to go back to that jurisdiction to terminate it. That is a shifting point of law right now. The law is evolving very quickly on that in terms of what one state will recognize and what another state will not. So, again, you have to be very up to date on what the state of the law is, which gets to redundancy. Even if you can't enter into a formal relationship under state law, you can do things like enter into contracts. You can enter into a property agreement. You can enter into a partnership agreement that says, this is how we're going to handle our financial affairs and our personal affairs. These are the rights we're going to confer on each other. And chances are a court's going to honor at least part of it. Again, it's going to depend on the jurisdiction. It's going to depend on what the contract looks like. But it gives you something as a backup in terms of how are you going to split property that you've acquired while you're in the relationship if the law doesn't allow you to do that. What are you going to do in terms of health care decision making and those kinds of things? States will have separate mechanisms in place that have nothing to do with same-sex couples. You need to take advantage of those mechanisms and make sure you have as much in place as possible. The other thing I'd say on the partnership issue is that sort of the flip side of it is that if the state has a mechanism in place to protect same-sex couples, it expects you to use it. And what I tell students in family law when we talk about relationships, if you're a heterosexual couple and you're not married, you don't get the benefits of marriage. And the state will say, well, you could have just gotten married if you wanted all those benefits that go with marriage. With same-sex couples, if there's something like domestic partnership or civil union available and you do not avail yourself of that option, then you risk having a state court say, well, wait a minute, why didn't you? If you're really serious about this relationship, why didn't you take the legal step that you could take? So there's sort of a quid pro quo. If the rights are there, you need to take advantage of them if you want to be able to invoke the benefits that they carry with them. Now, the other part of same-sex relationships has to do with parenting, and Sharon's going to talk more specifically about second-parent adoption, but there are very complex issues that relate to parenting for same-sex couples, too. And again, there's a tremendous amount of variation state to state in what states do in terms of whether they allow second parent adoption that she's going to discuss, how they recognize parenthood generally, and so forth. And again, there's a lot of experimentation. California has decisions on the books where they have recognized parenthood by estoppel, where parents have entered into a contract, and one of them then tried to disavow the contract and say the partner was not a parent, and the court says, you had this contract, you are stopped from trying to do that in court now. There's another case from a couple of years ago where they used the Uniform Partnership Act to say that the second parent had acted like a partner, fulfilled all the requirements of parenthood, and was legally recognized as a parent. If you're in a same-sex relationship, it's probable, or in a lot of cases, one of the partners is going to be a biological parent to the child. They're either going to be the genetic parent or the gestational parent or both. And if they're a biological parent, they're going to be a legal parent and have legal parent rights and responsibilities. The questions are what happens for the other person, or what happens if one individual adopts the child and the other parent has not adopted. And you need to make sure that you've got those rights in place. Now, the difference between the couple relationship, though, and adoption is that if you manage to undertake a second parent adoption or have a same-sex couple that has adopted a child, that adoption generally will be recognized across state lines as things stand right now. There's a case out of the Tenth Circuit from last year that involved Oklahoma's ban on gay adoptions, and there were couples that had moved with their children across state lines, and the court held that full faith and credit required recognition of those adoptions. Why? Because, first of all, I think there's a child involved, and the child has the rights and the status of having that parent-child relationship, and even though the court doesn't say so explicitly, I think they're very sensitive to the kid's rights as opposed to just the couple's rights. But the other thing is that when you have an adoption, you do have a court judgment in place, and full faith and credit is strongest when you're talking about the judgment of one court and how that's going to be honored in another court. So because a court process is required to go through adoption, there's some strength there. But again, you want to make sure you've got some redundancies. You want to make sure that you have a parenting agreement in place so that there's an understanding that you're both treating each other as parents. You want to make sure you've got guardianship papers drawn up, a will drawn up, all the kinds of things to safeguard the child in event the parent who is the legal parent, if one of them is a legal parent, dies and the other parent needs to take over. Again, as with partnership relationships, if there's a mechanism in place, then states expect you to use it. So, for example, some states recognize a doctrine called de facto parenthood, which is basically if you've lived with the kid, taken care of the kid, been in a parent-child relationship with the approval of your partner, then you at least get some parenthood rights, at least the benefits of visitation, maybe even custody. Okay, but there are courts that have held that if you could have gone through a domestic partnership arrangement, or if you could have undertaken a second parent adoption, and you choose not to, then the court will not extend those rights to you. So, again, you need to know what the law is, take advantage of what you have, and then make sure that you've got some safeguards in place, particularly if you're going to be moving interstate.
Hanging in there, y'all. I'm going to sort of do my report from the ground and a little bit more of what's going on out there in the trenches, at least in North Carolina. And so, given the limited time frame, that I'm going to talk less details about the law. But particularly a lot of what Kathy just said, the practicalities of doing what she's been talking about doing, and also how we can't avoid all the politics that's involved in this, and how the politics influences the courts and everyone else. So that's what I'd like to do. I want to, in terms of particularly custody issues, I think the first wave of gay parenting issues were more people coming out of marriages, heterosexual marriages, where and had decided that they were gay and had left the marriage for that reason, and they were trying to get custody of their children. And back when I came out of law school, it was like you lost custody, essentially. If you were gay, the assumption was, and everybody's fearful, that you would lose custody. And unfortunately, the very latest case that is still in this state was one I was involved in that went up to the Supreme Court here, involving a gay father who essentially raised his two children for several years. Mom had left, went off with her boyfriend, was living with her boyfriend, and saw the kids only in the summer. And then when she found out he was gay, she freaked and demanded custody, and in fact got custody. And although we did win in the Court of Appeals, we lost in the Supreme Court, and basically the court said that living for they actually, I think in a sense, to not be discriminatory and say this was only affecting same-sex couples, they said it for all unmarried couples in North Carolina. If you're not married and you're living with your children, you're creating an immoral, detrimental environment to your children, and that's wrong, and you shouldn't have custody, essentially, which really sent a lot of shockwaves through all the family law bar, because it was sort of going back to that 50s model, too, that, you know, women used to be women would lose custody if they were living with their boyfriends and not married, too, and it was sort of sending us back in that direction. But in one sense, unfortunately, it's ignored or gone around a lot, but that's still our last case out there. And it still inspires situations where people not so much, don't so much lose custody nowadays, but they have things in their orders, like one woman who must ensure that no female with whom she has a homosexual relationship be allowed in the presence of the minor child at any time. Another order I've seen where the parent can't take the child anywhere where there are known homosexuals. So I have these envisions of going to a party. Excuse me, before I come in the room, I have to take a vote here. Or before you go to the softball field, you have to check out how many people are there. So, and the probably one of the major ones is that you can't live with someone either opposite or same sex without being married. Well, that works for opposite sex folks. They can get married if they want to live together. And but unfortunately, since we don't allow gay people to get married, they can't. They can't get out from under that restriction. And I'm just working with a guy right now who agreed to that restriction when he separated because he wanted custody of his children and he wasn't thinking about relationships in the future, and now he's somewhat stuck in that place. So those are the kinds of things that are being faced out there right now. And I think it's going to become more and more issues that the courts are going to have to deal with in North Carolina. We don't have any statutes about same-sex parents. We don't, the courts just don't know what to do with this. Yet, on the other hand, it's estimated that we probably have 4,000 to 10,000 same-sex households with children in North Carolina. One-third of lesbian couples and one-fifth of gay male couples are raising children. And interestingly, the highest percentage of same-sex couples with children live in the South, so we can wonder why that is. But and just a couple other thoughts to keep in the general framework is, yes, I agree with Kathy, you've got to do all those documents and really protect yourself doubly, triply. But unfortunately, all that redundancy costs a lot of money, and that's one really unfairness. A heterosexual couple can go plop down $50 for a marriage license and they get those 1,138 laws to protect them, whereas a gay couple, in order to even, to get the most protections they can, they have to spend literally thousands and thousands of dollars to get all these documents, and they can't get everything. They can't get workers' compensation benefits or Social Security benefits, they can't contract for those things. They can only contract about financial things between them. And then, interesting again, as Kathy said, the the if you don't use the laws that are out there. So finally, we're getting some laws that are positive and helpful. Yet on the other hand, now we have another double bind that if you don't use them, the courts are going to presume you didn't intend to share property. You didn't intend to parent together because you didn't do those things. So that's another little major problem out there. And also to keep in mind, contrasting the difference between a one-night stand that results in pregnancy and the rights that that biological father has versus versus a parent, a same-sex parent who's raised a child who has gone through incredible amount of work to help create the child through inseminations and all this sort of stuff, and it walks and still has no rights. And it's not a slam on men at all. It's just it's very conveniently. I mean, that's just that one act gets a man all those particular rights, whereas a same-sex partner would still has absolutely nothing. So given that there is no law, we right now in North Carolina have three cases in the Court of Appeals that will be decided who knows when, and that could be some politics in that, but that are involving disputes with same-sex couples that were together and then split up and had children. And this is the second wave of gay parenting issues. Unfortunately, I think the first wave, there was a lot of being fueled from homophobia and that being used against folks. It's really regrettable that in this second wave, it's parents doing it against each other, and despite the fact that they may have made this agreement to jointly parent, they went through all this stuff to get pregnant, and then once they separate, the one that has a legal custody, whether biologically or because they were the initial adoptive parent, they say, sorry, this person, I mean, the stories are they were a roommate, they were a nanny, they were just part of the village that helped me raise my child. You know, those are all the stories that come up, and that's really unfortunate that so where are where we're fighting the battles now is within the community itself. So in these cases, there's three cases, two out of Durham, one out of Orange County. Two out of the three, the trial judge found that the non-biological parent was a legal parent. They used, in one case specifically, used the equitable parenthood, you know, there was parent by estoppel because once they had gone through all this, for the biological parent, should not be able to come in and say, sorry, she doesn't have any rights. So in one particular case, it was that. And then the other case, it was just more she's a legal parent. The judges, nobody knows how to write these orders. Nobody knows what the language we should be because we're just sort of struggling with it. And in the third case, the judge found that the other parent did not have any legal rights based more on the testimony of the biological parent. She just intended to do it herself. You know, it was all her idea. And, you know, even though it was sort of classic, the other one in the delivery room and all that sort of stuff, the judge felt in that case. So it's going to be up to the Court of Appeals to decide what the trial court judges, what framework they should use. The first issue is a sort of a standing one. Does the non-legal parent have standing to come into court? And I think that's a pretty easy answer based on our custody statute, and that provides any person can come into court, and then case law that follows that. So I don't think that's a problem. The second question is whether the trial courts, can they make their decision based on equitable parentage or intended parent to stop de facto parent, psychological parent, or any of those legal theories? Can we just, our courts just apply those? And do they have the legal authority to do that? And if they feel like they don't, the probably more issue that the courts will decide on is whether or not under our case law, which for those of you who've taken family law would be Peterson versus Rogers leading up to Price v. Howard being the major case, is that, you know, parents have paramount superior rights, and they, if you're a non-parent trying to get custody away from a parent, you're going to have a tough time because you first have to show that that parent has given up their paramount rights, either because they were neglectful, abuse, all those kinds of unfitness, or even if they were fit but acted in a manner that was inconsistent. And so the crux of the question in these cases do you lose your paramount rights if you've allowed someone else to act as a parent? You made a decision together. You went through all the doctor stuff together. You're raising them. You've signed all these papers. The one particular case did have a parenting agreement in it. Given all that, does that mean you lose your paramount rights? And so we're sort of, that's a framework we have to fit our scenarios into, and that would be probably the most, the way that we could win the most, given what the existing law is. Unfortunately, the sort of arguments that are being raised is, you know, how do you distinguish this from a step-parent case, and how do you know if a nanny or a family member, just because they live in the household, does that mean they get to be parents? And those are some of the issues that have come up. But I think what we're arguing is, you know, if it's a joint decision made prior to birth or a joint decision to adopt. And in North Carolina, only one person can adopt, so only one can do it legally. If you can easily distinguish that sort of situations from step-parent, which came into the picture later on. It wasn't a joint decision. Just turning to, so in all those cases, there was no step-parent adoption. And the best solution we can come up with is doing step-parent adoptions, which have been around for over 25, 30 years, started in California, and now the majority of states, either through statute, through case law, or just because trial court judges feel they have the authority to do it, they're being done in over most of the states in the country. I had to wait 25 years to do them because for one reason, the clerk of court in Durham County was clerk for over 25 years, and it wasn't until we had the first time we had a new election, a new clerk, and we actually got involved in the campaign and went to the candidates and asked them, well, what would you do about these second parent adoptions? Would you grant them? Would you work with us on them? And you know, essentially. Actually, it turned out, to my surprise, both candidates said, yes, we would. I'm like, oh, no, now what do we do? Because we can't, you know, who do we endorse? And but they did pick one candidate to endorse, and a lot of political groups worked with him, and I think that really made a difference. And he knows he, you know, won by a few votes. I think he knows a lot of folks in the gay community, helped him get elected, and that's gone a long way to make this happen. But the crux of the problem with second parent adoptions is, if you read our statutes, it basically says if you do an independent adoption, you do an adoption like this, obviously the initial biological parent loses his or her rights, and a new family is substituted, a new person is substituted. Well, obviously that's not what we want, because then you end up with just still one legal parent, just a different one. So based on case law in other states, particularly in California and Pennsylvania, there's an argument that terminating the parents' rights was for their benefit. It's a statutory benefit for them. They no longer are a parent. They don't have to pay child support anymore. They don't want to, you know, have custody. They don't want to raise a child. But you can, if a statute is for your benefit, you can waive that. So you can waive that, say, thank you, that's nice, but I don't want that benefit. I don't want my rights terminated. So based on that, we can say, we don't want our rights terminated. So despite what the statute says, you know, I argue that the court can waive that benefit. If you look at the purpose of adoption, statutes, stability in families, best interest of the child, lots of authority the clerk has to waive certain requirements, that on all those bases combined, you can grant second parent adoption. So far to date, we have convinced about 5 different judges in Durham County to do them. Why I have to leave early is because I'm going to go to Orange County and hopefully convince my first judge in Orange County to do them in Orange County today. And, you know, we eventually want to move out to other states. But it takes a lot of work, and this is where the law may be one thing, but there's a lot of other things you have to do, like meeting with the clerks and judges and educating folks and telling them about it and talking about it. And so you really have to lay groundwork, because we don't want several cases that are denying them. So we really... I've been very careful about how we go about doing this. The good news then is that we've had done probably close to 150 children now have been adopted. And anybody throughout the state can come to Durham and do them in Durham. So even though we're only been doing them in Durham, you know, we have people from all over the state doing them, because the clerk's been willing to do that. again, like the custody situation, there I knew this day was going to come, is the first couple splits up, and the biological mom who consented to the second parent adoption says, well, I didn't, know what I was doing, she had all sorts of other issues. She didn't like the behavior of the other party, but so she basically challenged the adoption, and in their custody hearing, she said the adoption should be invalid. And we were really nervous, really worried about that. But wonderfully, the trial court judge, and of course this is in another county, said that she, as a judge, was equitably estopped from now setting aside this adoption that the biological mom had consented to, and only now that the party's breaking up is she denying it. So the judge ruled that she would consider the adoption valid, and that is significant because then they both appeared in front of the judge on equal basis as both legal parents. So the burden was not greater in one than the other, and then they went on to a custody determination. That case is on the way up to the Court of Appeals, in my optimistic days, I could be optimistic. Maybe the Court of Appeals will hopefully agree with everything and would be fabulous if they agreed and said that these adoptions are valid, and then we wouldn't have any questions. We could just open the floodgates. Although I would say the district court judges should be happy or glad, at least gives them a basis, then they don't have to go through this whole thing, what legal parental theory do they need or whatever. They could just proceed with them, with the parties as both legal parents. So that's my argument I use a lot to judges, is this is giving them the framework and the basis and making it easier for the custody decisions that they have to do. And I see my time is up, and just my only unpaid political announcement for those of you who vote in North Carolina is really looking at the appellate. We do elect appellate judges, and it's crucial, and we have some very excellent candidates running this time around, so I urge you all to educate yourself on those judges, and they'll really help influence them in the future, these future kind of cases. Thanks.
Good afternoon. I want to take just a minute because I want to thank Emily very much and all the members of Duke Out for hosting this panel. They've been leaders on this campus all year long, from marching in the Pride Parade to standing out on the plaza on National Coming Out Day and reaching thousands across this campus, to hosting the first North Carolina Equality Conference, and they've shown some real admirable leadership on this campus this year. And so I just want to acknowledge you for all you do, you great bunch, and I just love working with you. So Duke University this past year decided to include gender identity in its non-discrimination policy. So I'm wondering, I think you've been sitting long enough and listening. Tell me, what does that mean? Does this work?
So what does that mean? No, it doesn't work. You take it off.
He can speak loudly. Somebody. Go.
What does it mean?
What?
You're protected. Gender identity, you're protected. What does that mean? Who's protected? Nobody knows? Yes.
People who think of themselves as a different gender than they are biologically, so it's transgender.
So people who think of themselves as a different gender than they are biologically, okay? Anybody else have an idea about that?
Thank you. Anybody else have an idea about that? So does that include someone who historically might call herself a butch? Does that mean that she's protected? Yes.
I think the way I see it is just that
and I'm not a law student, I got to let you know. But
I'm not a law student either, so we have perfect
Just that there are no real parameters for that, that it's not something that you should be judging on, regardless of what you see as the idea of this is acceptable or this isn't acceptable, that it's not something that you should be judging on in the first place as towards Duke Law, is that correct? Or towards Duke University, excuse me.
Well, I guess it depends on who you are. The big question around gender identity, I think, in most places, is what exactly does that mean? And that's exactly the dilemma that I think we're going to face here at Duke University. The transgender community, who are members of the transgender community? Who's included in that? Emily?
I mean, I guess I could be, but people whose gender is more something that I would consider between your ears. It's more psychological, it's the way you express yourself, it's the way you identify, and traditionally we're kind of socialized to think that biological sex, i.e., you know, chromosomes, primary sex characteristics, are then immediately combined with our cultural idea of what is feminine, what is masculine. And so people who are transgender often are pigeonholed as not kind of fitting the social role that usually assigned. It's my best.
Okay. Offer. So there's some question of what is a person's sex. There's also some question of how do they identify their gender. Who are some of the people that are included in the trans community? Traditionally. Cross-dressers, do they count? Drag kings, drag queens? What's the difference between somebody who identifies as transgender and somebody who identifies as transsexual? And who's covered and who's not covered? And what did our Board of Trustees think? They were asked to include gender identity and expression. They voted gender identity. What do you think they meant? What do you think they meant? Who did they mean to protect? None of you were in the boardroom? Nobody wants to venture. Well, just guess. What would you say? Okay, we're brave.
So, yeah, I'll be brave. Well, okay. I mean, it sounds vaguely, you said that it was protect, that expression was not protected, but that
they chose not to include expression.
So it seems vaguely reminiscent of kind of a don't ask, don't tell policy.
Well, that's interesting.
To say that you can have the identity but not express it, I mean, that's something that...
Yes, that does raise that question, yeah. Doesn't it? Did you want to comment? No. Okay. Yes.
Well, what sort of materials were they given about what they were voting on? What's the legislative history of
it? Yeah.
Who spoke to the right. Trustees about it? What did the, you know, not that Scalia would have looked at that, but... You know.
Right. Well, I believe that the Office for Institutional Equity spoke to the Board of Trustees about it. But, and so in my discussions, the best I can get is that what people think the board meant was that they were meaning to protect people who fall under the category that the medical community and the psychiatric community have traditionally called people who are transsexual. So that these are people who don't necessarily just bend gender rules or gender norms, but these are people who actually believe that they are the opposite sex and want to become, in a physical sense, the opposite sex. So it would seem that here at Duke, at least, what we meant when we protect gender identity is that we protect people who have taken certain steps to actually change their sex. Now, what's complicated about that? Does that seem kind of clear? No. Okay. What?
I said,
who's checking? Who's checking? Yeah. Like how are they going? How are you going to know? But. Okay. So if somebody decides that they are transsexual, and they may call themselves transgender because the language is very unclear at this point. And they decide to change themselves physically. What are some of the things they can do to change themselves?
Change their genitals.
Change their genitals. And when we speak of genitals, we tend to speak of things like vaginas, penises, those kinds of things, right? Okay, what else can a person do physically? Yes?
Hormone therapy.
Hormone therapy, okay, so we could change at least the levels of different hormones, given that we all have all of them anyway, okay?
They may just choose to dress and even change a name or identify, essentially live as a member of the opposite sex.
Okay, in that instance though, they would not be, as far as we know, considered protected. That would be considered expression, okay? Certainly, people can have breasts removed, they can have breasts added, they can have ovaries removed, they can have vaginas removed, they can have penises inverted. But before getting to that step, they can also utilize hormone therapy. Some males to females will, for instance, have their Adam's apple shaved down. And there are many physical things that one could do. That whole process is called transitioning. Part of the question is, how many of those steps does a person have to take to be considered protected under gender identity? What is protected? How much of that is protected? And at what point are you protected? In the state of North Carolina, as far as we know, right now, a person's sex does not change until it's changed on the birth certificate. And it will not be changed on the birth certificate until they've had what used to be called sexual reassignment surgery, which is now often called gender confirmation surgery. Okay? So until that birth certificate is changed, they are not considered to be anything other than the sex they were assigned at birth. So it's all a very easy, clear situation, and I'll end with that.
And now it's open for questions, comments, any questions you have for the panelists, anything like that. And I'll try and referate.
I just have a question for Professor Chemerinsky, but I welcome anybody else's input. One of the things that you mentioned is that it would be nice for protection to have some level of scrutiny. I think that you mentioned heightened scrutiny. I just wonder whether or not there's any fear that sort of the wrong level of scrutiny will at some point have a negative effect. I mean, have you seen like in at least in racial discrimination cases where strict scrutiny has at least recently tended to undermine some steps that folks are trying to take, you know, specifically affirmative action. So is there any fear that the wrong level of scrutiny that's applied will have an adverse impact in the future?
In gender discrimination, sex-based discrimination, there's been that debate. It used to be that women's rights advocates uniformly argued that sex discrimination should get the same level of scrutiny as race discrimination. When the issue was last reconsidered by the Supreme Court in 1996, United States versus Virginia, women's rights advocates were on both sides. Some, for the first time, were arguing that it should just be intermediate scrutiny, and some for the traditional strict scrutiny. The reason why some who had previously argued for strict scrutiny said intermediate scrutiny is they said laws that discriminate against women will get struck down under intermediate scrutiny anyway. They said, but to the extent that there are affirmative action programs benefiting women, there are some that will fail if it goes to strict scrutiny, but get upheld under intermediate scrutiny, so we're better off sticking with intermediate scrutiny. And there was that split. And the Supreme Court stuck with intermediate scrutiny, but then had this additional language that there's to be an exceedingly persuasive justification, so sort of moved it. I don't see the danger here, and I'll let the other panelists, there just isn't enough in the way of affirmative action to protect people who are gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgendered, that you're going to put those kinds of programs in jeopardy by moving to intermediate or strict scrutiny. But there is still so much blatant discrimination in state laws across the country against people on the basis of sexual orientation that I see enormous benefit to heightened scrutiny in relatively little cost.
I was kind of wondering how international law plays in all this in terms of respecting other nations, if there are any, that grant greater rights to LGBT couples.
That's evolving. There was a case just a couple of weeks ago, I think, out of New York that dealt with a marriage in Canada because Ontario recognizes same-sex marriages. And a couple had gone to Canada to marry and then were back in New York and wanted to claim like health care benefits or something that's associated with marriage. And the trial court said yes, they would honor it. But that's not something you would necessarily see in any jurisdiction other than New York. There is, there was a conference here about a week ago that dealt with conflicts of laws, and there was discussion about same-sex marriage and partnership benefits and so forth in Europe. And the patchwork looks a lot in Europe like it does here. That is, there are a number of jurisdictions that or countries that have same-sex marriage, a number that have some sort of partnership. The partnership isn't uniform across country lines and so forth. And the same pattern is holding there, that is that if you go from one country that has, that recognizes same-sex marriage, for example, to another one that does or that recognizes partnership, you'll at least get the benefits that, that the jurisdiction you're moving to would get. There's some influence in the U.S. on what's happening internationally, but the whole idea of how much we look to international law generally, particularly in an area like family law where it's very localized law, there's a huge amount of policy debate about how much we should be doing it. But like I said, there are at least a couple of cases out there now where the questions coming about what's happened internationally and the courts seem to be treating it the same way that they would be looking at it if it were from another state in terms of what are they going to recognize or what are they going to not. I'm expecting that the New York case will get flipped if it goes up.
So just to follow up, there aren't any, right now there are no treaties governing this kind of thing?
No. There are treaties that deal with some international aspects of family law relating to things like parental kidnapping, child custody disputes, those kinds of things that are actually protective of what the home jurisdiction does. But there aren't any treaties in place that we're in right now that would require the U.S. to honor, that I'm aware of, that would require the U.S. to honor what's happening internationally.
I was actually glad that you brought up the election issue and coming up, just because there are so many of us that I think are interested in that. And I know there's been some concern written about lately that issues in the community aren't really in the forefront this election around as they have been in the past election necessarily. And so for some of us, it's harder to find information on how particular candidates both nationally and locally might really stand on some of these. So I was wondering if you had some good websites or things for the layman to kind of get in there and see where do these folks actually stand on some of these issues since they're not being reported in the mainstream media as much.
That's a very good point. I think it's just gearing up now. I will say you can go to the State Board of Elections and look at the candidates' names, and nowadays most candidates have websites and you could go to their websites. Of course, when it's judicial, there's less issue orientation that's probably going to be on their websites and all. The equalityNC.org is the statewide LGBT political organization, and they do, and they probably will, in the past they haven't done judicial endorsements. I think they're going to start getting maybe into more to that, so I'm not sure whether they'll be endorsing just for the PAC regulation requirements, but I'm not a professor, I can say, I would urge you to look at, like in the Supreme Court race in particular, as a family law practitioner, I'm very excited that Suzanne Reynolds is running for the Supreme Court, and those of you who do family law took the course, she writes the treatise on family law in North Carolina, the four-volume treatise that's out there. She's a family law professor at Wake Forest University and has been very active herself in many organizations. So I'll just put a plug out there for her, and I'm not sure about all the races. The other one that I'm particularly interested in on the Court of Appeals level is in one race, we now have our first openly gay appellate judge, and that's John Arrowwood, and he's was appointed last year by the governor, and he's running his first race. So he's and he was on the panel in the last custody cases that I talked about. So those are just two races, and then you know, and I would, as I said, urge you to look at, and there'll be some materials coming out from the Bar Association and stuff, some general stuff. But.
I have a question for the panel. I was curious if any of you have run into situations where taking advantage of one law in one state or of one organization, not organization, but ends up actually hurting a couple. I ran into another don't ask, don't tell situation where they couldn't do a second parent adoption because it was a public statement of their relationship, and so the military could use that to kick her out of the military. But they couldn't get the child covered under the military because she couldn't explain how she has the child because the stay-at-home mom is the birth mother and she's at work. So I'm wondering if any other double binds that come to mind?
I know for people who are doing foreign adoptions, a lot of times you have to sign a document that you are not, you know, that you're not a homosexual or something. And so, therefore, if you do that and then you come back home and do a second parent adoption, then you're admitting that you're in sort of this relationship. So I know people who are fearful of doing second parent adoptions for that reason.
And because in the international context, when you have to, if the foreign nation imposes restrictions, then you also have to swear to the U.S. government in order to get the visa to come back into the country with the child that you have fulfilled all of the country's requirements. So not only have you lied to a foreign nation, you've lied to the federal government, and that's a federal crime. So there would be some, I mean, I don't know of anybody who's been prosecuted for that, but that would be a serious consequence to worry about.
Thank you.
Thank you. There's a few flyers and